All right, thank you. Good to have everybody this morning. And we're going to continue on with our study of the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven. And I want you to turn with me to Luke chapter 16 this morning, if you would. Chapter 16, verse 16. I want to show you at the beginning of the lesson this morning, start points and end points. That's the best way I know how to say it. Obviously, from what you're going to see, these are definitely markers in time. Father, bless your word. And we pray, Heavenly Father, you give us a heart, Lord, that wants to understand and receive it. And then give me the gift of teaching. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, now, in Luke chapter number 16, verse 16, the scripture says, the law and the prophets were until John. This is John the Baptist, not John the Apostle. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presseth into it. All right, now it's obvious from here, from this, that there is a stopping point and a starting point. That's what I just keep that in mind, because that's what's so important about understanding the way the New Testament is laid out. All right, now turn to the book of Acts, chapter number 28. Verse 28. Acts 28, 28. Scripture says, be it known therefore unto you that the salvation of God is sent unto the Gentiles, and that they will hear it. Now hold your place right there. Hold your place right there. And go to the book of Matthew chapter number 10. Matthew 10, verse 5. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans. Enter ye not. Now hold that, look at that, and then go over here to the book of Acts 28, verse 28. Be it known therefore unto you that the salvation of God is sent unto the Gentiles, and that they will hear it. Now, between where the Lord said, do not go into the way of the Gentiles, and in Acts 28, 28, where he said, the Apostle Paul says, now salvation is going to the Gentiles. It should be, I mean, if you think it at all, this should raise up a flag in your head to say, well, good night, then there's something going on in between this. Absolutely. All right, now going over here to the book of Hebrews, chapter number 9. Hebrews 9. And verse number 15. Hebrews chapter number 9, verse number 15. And for this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament. Now the scripture says there is one God and one mediator between God and men. Who? Who now? The man. Make absolutely certain that it's said that way. The man, Christ Jesus. The God-man. All right, now watch carefully. And for this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Now look at verse number 16 very carefully. For where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. For a testament is of force after men are dead. Here's another line. See this? Here's a point in time. This is what I'm calling your attention to. A point in time. Chronology. For a testament is a force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. So therefore, the testament the New Testament. He said, he took the cup and said, this is the New Testament in my blood. All right. Could anyone therefore, I'm going to ask you a simple question. Could anyone have been washed in the blood of Christ before the blood of Christ was shed?
No.
And the apostle, of course, says plainly, not with the blood of bulls and goats, but by his own blood he entered in. So therefore, a point in time. It's important now. If we're going to understand the New Testament, we've got to understand the chronology of it. There is definitely a chronology involved. Now, if we understand the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, we understand that there is a chronology involved, a time period. Law and the prophets until John. Who was the first one in the New Testament books, not the New Testament age, because Christ had to die for the New Testament to be ratified, to come into force, for the blood to be applied. So, but in the New Testament books, who was the first one in time and chronology to preach the kingdom of heaven? John the Baptist. But Matthew chapter number 3, John the Baptist stepped out, began to preach, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, here's what confuses, I think, a lot of times. Let's say, for example, you're standing on planet Earth right now, all right? We're on Earth. The Bible said in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Did I mess up? I messed up. What? Heaven and the earth. Is there a difference? Words are important. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Words are very important. All right, so in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. Now, where was he when he created all of this? Was he in heaven?
Yes.
Did he need a place to abide?
No.
Was there a place that he abode in? Has there been a place for God to abide in forever? In other words, the place that God abode in was there when God abode in it. I'm not trying to trip you up, but I'm trying to show you something. Which one's eternal, God or heaven? God. The Almighty has always been. There never was a time when he was not. Exactly. All right. When he created something, he creates it for creatures. All right. He creates it for creatures. Creation and creature are hand in hand. The etymology of the word comes from the same place. I'm a creature because I've been created. The heaven has been created. The earth has been created. A creation is for creatures. There's only one creator. There's only one eternal absolute being. That's the Almighty. And he manifested himself 2,000 years ago as the God-man. All right, now, this planet that I'm on, okay, I'm looking up into the sky. Let's say, for example, I'm standing here right now. I'm looking up into the sky. I'm in the northern hemisphere. And we're approaching March. We're approaching spring. If I were in Australia right now, what part of the year would I be in? Fall, exactly. You're in the southern hemisphere. Everything's reversed. All right, now, I'm standing on planet Earth, and I'm looking up into the sky. All right, I'm looking up into heaven, okay? What about those folks down on the bottom of the Earth? Where are they looking? Are they standing? Okay. How can they stand and walk around on the bottom of the Earth while I'm up here on the top of it? Gravity, exactly. All right. Now, when they look up, that's down for me. Right? I'm not trying to confuse you. I'm trying to show you a place. When I look up, I look this way. All right? That's down for them. Because if they're underneath me on the bottom of this globe, when they look down, they're looking up. All right. Here's the point. This earth is in heaven. How do you know that? If I went off into Mars or Saturn or Jupiter or any of the planets in our solar system and I looked toward Earth, where would I find it? In heaven. If I stand on Earth and look toward Mars and Uranus and Saturn and the rest of them, where would I look? I wouldn't look into the Earth. I would look where? Into heaven. Exactly. So when he created, heaven... He named the earth, but this earth is part of the creation of heaven. So when I say the kingdom of heaven, I'm using it in a broad sense. So some people have the idea, well, that's got to mean up above us, up into heaven. No, No, the kingdom of heaven is a physical, visible kingdom.
Amen.
Physical, visible. See, what's the kingdom of God then? It's a spiritual kingdom. He did. Yes, he did. He's one of the most mysterious creatures in the whole Bible. Or, well, let's not say creature. Let's just say he's he is. He's a mysterious being. But anyway, when you look, when you compare the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven, you've got two entirely different things. Look over here at John 3 now. Look at John chapter number 3. In John 3. All right, now look at this thing right here. Verse number 5. Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of what?" Now, okay. Some folks make this synonymous. They make the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven same thing. Probably you get into problems here. You get into trouble. Sometimes the kingdom of God and sometimes the kingdom of heaven are running simultaneously together. They are in concurrent. They are here together at the same time. There is a creature. And look in Isaiah chapter number 14. Isaiah chapter number 14. Isaiah chapter number 14 and verse number 13. "For thou said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation, the sides of the north." Who's the doing the talking here? First person, "I will." Who? It's Lucifer. That's who it says. "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning?" Verse number 12. Now, if you're Albert Pack, that's your God. But he's not my God. And these new Bibles and the new many of the new dictionaries and lexicons are confusing and confounding the identity of Lucifer with a bright morning star. Who is that? Exactly. All right, there are similarities, yes, and they jump on that and they go completely hog wild with it. Both are light bearers. One bears light, the other is the source of light.
Amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ is the source of light.
Amen.
Lucifer bore light. There was a time when in his exalted position, according to Isaiah 14, he had a throne. That's quite a thought. Where was it? You think about the earth. You think about the kingdoms on this earth. Look in Isaiah, in the book of Revelation 11, verse number 15. Revelation 11, 15. Revelation 11, 15. We're right smack in the middle of time of Jacob's trouble now. And here's what it says. "The seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever."
Amen.
Are they his now? No. No, no, no. The Roman Catholic Church believes they are, and they believe the Pope is the king over the kingdom of heaven, which is established right here on this earth. This is why they go to a basilica and they worship. You know what a basilica is? Comes from the Greek word basileus, which means a king. So therefore, they have him. Have you ever seen a picture of, have you ever seen a crucifix with Christ on it and a crown on his head? All right. They have him crowned now. All right. They have him crowned and ruling over this earth. It has to do with eschatology. It has to do with the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven. Catholics aren't the only ones that do that. Well, there's a great movement afoot in this country right now, the dominion theology. The Rick Warren and that group, people like that, that are pushing to build the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God right here on this earth. Are they going to succeed? They're going to bring a kingdom in, but it's not going to be his. Look at Luke chapter number 4 now in verse number 5. "The devil taking him up into an high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. Now, either he gave him an illusion, which I don't believe, because the Lord Jesus could not be fooled, or he gave him a, or he in spirit, somehow or another, which we don't fully understand, he was able to show him the kingdoms of this world in a moment of time. A moment of time means that either he showed him all of the kingdoms of Daniel, with the head of gold and the feet of clay and iron and everything in between. In other words, all the Gentile kingdoms. Either he showed him that, in other words, in chronology in the past into the future, or he showed him all the kingdoms of the world present at that time. I believe he showed him all the kingdoms of the world from the time that the first Adam lost the crown to the kingdom of heaven and the time the Lord Jesus Christ takes it back in Revelation chapter number 11 and verse number 15. He showed them to him. And here's what he said. He said, "These are mine to give to whomsoever I will." That's not an idle boast. He could. He gives men power. He has enormous spiritual power. He has not only the ability to deceive, he has the ability to empower someone, to give them power. And this is why men sell their soul for that kind of power. They can gain riches. The occult religions, every last one of them, have some sort of attached to them, some sort of way of having power. And usually the first step in that is through knowledge, through wisdom. If you'll look in Genesis carefully, you'll notice that when the devil spoke, when Satan spoke to Eve, he said, "God doth know that in the day you eat this fruit thereof, ye shall be as gods, knowing." This is this esoteric wisdom. This is this wisdom of the occult world. This is the wisdom of the Rosicrucians, the wisdom of the Knights Templar, the wisdom of the occult world that you get deeper and deeper into. And this is the wisdom that's mentioned in the book of Revelation, where it said, where they've known the depths of Satan. It's the kind of wisdom that men sell their soul for. For they can conjure up demonic powers with this kind of wisdom. But when they do that, they make themselves very vulnerable. And on top of that, Kundalini yoga. This spirit, this serpent that finds its source at the base of your spine, that wraps itself around your spine and then protrudes its head over the top of your head. Your power is being drawn from a serpent. That's the hidden wisdom that we're talking about here. This wisdom, this ability to know how to tap into that kind of power through yoga and meditation, through chakras that are found in the body. These are power points. These are places where power can be released. Have you ever noticed a Hindu that has a red spot in their head? You ever notice that red spot? You know, that's not for makeup. That's a spiritual thing. There's a reason for that being there. That's a spiritual point. Yes? A scabulous. I was there at it's where Satan's seat is. What's that place over there in the book of Revelation? I can't think of the name of it now, but there is down beneath it, there is this place of healing. Then on top, there is this big amphitheater, and then there's this Capernaum. No, it's not Capernaum. It's I can't think of it right now. I will in a minute. Pergamos. Thank you, brother. Pergamum. And that's where Satan's seat was located. All right. Have you ever wondered why that a serpent has anything to do with healing? Have you ever noticed that medical doctors? I saw it all the time in the military. Every last Navy doctor I ever saw had a pen on, and that had that serpent. Of course it is. But what is it? Why do they use a serpent? See. Why a serpent? What does a serpent have to do with healing? Pardon? It has been interjected by the devil himself in culture as far back as you can imagine. And it has and the association with a serpent is amazing at how the serpent raises its head practically in every culture, even in the heavens, in the constellations. There, the serpent is there, and it's a different study altogether, but you would be amazed at how the serpent is involved in this esoteric wisdom, this hidden wisdom, this revelation to man, this understanding. God's holding something back from you. See, that's the idea. That's the idea with Albert Pike when he said Lucifer is the true God and we worship him. And that this God of the Christians, this Adonai, he called him, said he's a false God. He doesn't want you to have any joy. He doesn't want you to have any satisfaction, fulfillment in this life. And the true God's Lucifer. And it goes even further back than that, because it goes back to the confrontation between Lucifer and the Lord Jesus Christ. There was a confrontation that took place, and there's a number of confrontations that takes place down through time. And there will be another one. When the heavens open with a great white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war, he will come back personally to take the serpent.
Amen.
But anyway, it's this wisdom, it's this knowledge, it's this understanding of something. And this is exactly what's going on out there with Rick Warren, one more time now, you know, to belabor it. When he brought these three doctors in to this health seminar he had in January, all you have to do, and I'm not misrepresenting anyone, just check out what these men teach and believe. And you'll find out that Kundalini Yoga, go back and pick up something written 20 years ago by the New Age movement itself, 30 years ago. Go pick up something written by a Hindu, not some crazed, ignorant Christian out here fooling around with something they don't understand. Go pick up something written by a Hindu. He'll tell you what Kundalini Yoga is. And he'll tell you the dangers involved with it. And he can tell you how it can lead you to demon possession and annihilation. In plain words, suicide. It can blow your very mind. You can get into that and wind up killing your family. There's danger in it. It's not a game, folks. It's not a physical exercise. I know it's presented that way, but it's far more than that. So that's something to keep in mind. All right. So now, this kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven, the Lord said in John chapter number 3, he said, you can't even see the kingdom of God unless you are born again. And you must be born of the Spirit. All right. He didn't say unless you're saved. Salvation accompanies the new birth. It is part of it. It is simultaneous with it. But the Old Testament saints were saved. You must be born again. The new birth must take place. When does it take place? It takes place when the New Testament, new covenant, blood shed. Because there's no way that a soul who's lost the image of God can be restored. Look over here in Hebrews chapter number 1. In Hebrews 1. Verse 1. God, who at sundry times and divers manners spake in time past the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. Now watch this. Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. Whose person? Which God? God who? God the Father, that invisible spirit being that no man has ever seen. Exactly. Hold your place, right? I'm glad you called that. I might as well do it while we're at it. Look at Colossians. Hold your place in Hebrews 1. Turn to Colossians chapter number 2. Verse number 9. He's the express image of his person. Now look at verse 9. For in him dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead, what? Bodily. The body, bodily, physically. The fullness of the Godhead. That never happened before. Never happened again. Because there's only one that can happen, that could be. I can't qualify. I will be like him. What he is, I will be as far as a creature can be taken. But I'll never be God.
Amen.
Never will. New Agers teach that. They teach they are. Now, look at this carefully. The Lord Jesus Christ came and restored what the first Adam lost.
Amen.
All right. Now, let's go back and look at chronology before we get too far ahead of ourselves. because we're jumping a little bit. We get in here and get excited and just run race, take off without the baton, you know. You ever run a relay? I've done that in high school. I used to run a relay. Wasn't fast enough for the 100-yard dash, but I was fast enough for the 440. So we'd run the relay. But if you didn't get the baton, forget it. I don't care if you beat everybody. You better have that baton in your hand. You get to the finish line. So in the New Testament is a point in time. Okay. I want to show you how that in a point in time, the Lord began to shut the eyes of the Jews. At a point in time. Look at Matthew chapter number 13. Matthew chapter number 13. And verse number 14. Let's go back to verse number 13. Matthew 13, 13. I'm going to show you what precipitated this, what led up to it. Matthew 13, 13. Therefore, speak I to them in parables. That comes from the Greek word para bole. Para, the Greek preposition para, means to go alongside of. Okay? Para bole, a message or thought or action going alongside of. So here's the truth. Let's see. Here's the truth. Right here. This is the truth. This is the truth. Absolute. Here's the parable. Truth is going forward, and the parable covers the truth. The parable is true. He never preached a lie to anybody. God's not the source of lies. But in order to understand the truth, you need the illumination of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Right? Amen. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, foolishness to him, neither can he know them, spiritually discerned. Here's the truth. A parable takes the truth and goes with it. Therefore, you must be able to understand the parable to open the truth. So it is purposely given to shroud the truth. Hide the truth. Say, what do you mean? Look at the next verse. Look at the next verse. Matthew chapter number 13. Verse number 13. Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seeing, see not, hearing, hear not, neither do they understand. Now he goes back to the Old Testament and makes an application and shows them why. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Esaias, which is the Old Testament Isaiah, which saith, by hearing ye shall hear, and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see, and shall not perceive. He quoted Isaiah chapter number 6 right here in verse 9. He quotes, the New Testament quotes, the 6th chapter of Isaiah and the 9th verse 7 times. 7 times. The New Testament quotes it. Now, one of the greatest studies of the Bible is to study the New Testament quotations of the Old Testament. That's a wonderful study. The New Testament quotes, Matthew quotes. Of course, the Lord Jesus is doing the talking, but Matthew's the one who wrote the human instrument. He quotes Isaiah chapter number 6 and verse 9, okay? And he applies it. In plain words, he quotes the scripture, then makes an application of it. It's quoted 7 times in the New Testament. In 3 specific places, there is a definite application of the Old Testament scripture to the Jews. Every time he quotes Isaiah chapter number 6, he quotes it and applies it as it relates to the Jew. Now watch the final quotation of it. Here's the last time that it's quoted as it applies to the Jews. Look at Romans chapter number 11. It shows you where they are. I'm not talking about the last time it's quoted, but I'm talking about the last time it's quoted as it applies to the Jew. Romans chapter number 11 and verse number 8. Verse 8. According as it is written, God hath given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see and ears that they should not hear unto this day. This day is the day that Romans was written. Unto this day, David said, let their table be made a snare, a trap, and a stumbling block. Okay. The first time that it's quoted and applied, it has a definite reference to one of the Godhead. The next time that it is quoted and applied, it has a direct reference to another of the Godhead. And the third time it is quoted and applied, it has a direct reference to another of the Godhead. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost make up the Godhead. In plain words, it is God Almighty in agreement with Himself. As He relates to mankind, He sets judgment down on man. And when He puts it down on him, He quotes the Old Testament scripture to give him authority to do it. He cannot break the Bible. He can't break the scripture. Everything God does, He does it within the bounds of the book He wrote. But look what they did for God to do what He did. Look in Matthew chapter number 12 and verse number 14. Matthew 12:14. Then the Pharisees went out and held a council against him, how they might do what?
Destroy him.
This is reasonably early on. They had already made their mind up. They were going to do away with this man. All right, to this day, if you take the Babylonian Talmud, look at it, you'll find Christ encoded all through that thing. And every Jew that's raised up in an observant Jewish home is taught that the Lord Jesus Christ was born of probably a Roman soldier, illegitimate, that everything that he did it by the power of the devil, demon-possessed. He was a magician, and that he's in hell. Now, what they give out for public consumption is another thing altogether. But that's what the Talmud teaches. That's bad. But that came to them straight from this bunch right here, the Pharisees. That's where it came from. At the time of the writing of the New Testament, the Babylonian Talmud did not exist in written form. But the Babylonian Talmud existed in verbal form, and a young man memorized millions of words. He memorized this. This was all hidden in his heart. Now think about it for a minute. Think about it. If you keep something hidden in your heart that's never written down, you can't be checked out. You can't be documented. There's no paper trail. You see what I mean? And it wasn't until centuries later that it was written down, and then a Jew by the name of Maimonides codified all of that. Plain words, you're able to find your way around inside the Talmud by codifying it. That's what happened. He said, you have made the word of God of none effect by the traditions of men. What traditions is he talking about? Touch not, taste not, handle not, the Apostle Paul said to the early church. He said, one man esteemeth one day above another. One man has a Sabbath here, a Sabbath there. There was more than one Sabbath, you understand, don't you? Many, many, many Sabbaths. But the Apostle Paul said, these are a shadow. They are weak and beggarly elements. He's referring back to something that was handed down orally, a oral tradition that was picked up when they were in Babylon. They were cast from their people. Jeremiah said they'd spend 70 years. They did. While they were there, they picked up this garbage from Babylon that became the way they interpreted the Word of God. Instead of interpreting the Bible, let Moses interpret Moses. Instead of letting Moses interpret Moses, they ran to the interpretations of the Babylonians. What did they get into? They got in a mess. Because when they did that, they got right off into this heathenism, into occultism, into all the religions that were in vogue at that day. They came back believing in, they had every kind of a perversion imaginable applied to the revelation of Scripture. And the Babylonian Talmud bears it out. It's full of it. Alfred Edersheim, in his work on the life and times of Christ, goes, he's got a huge section in the back of it talking about what the Jews believed 2,000 years ago. One section you ought to read is what they believed about demons. Demons. And if you want something that'll give you edification and build up your faith in the Bible, read what the Jews believed about demons and read what the New Testament says about demons, and you'll find they're two entirely different worlds. What the Jews believed about demons is as purely pagan as it can be. And the reason it is because they were influenced by pagans. The New Testament, on the other hand, does not get into this wild, crazy garbage that they were teaching about demons. And when I say that, I don't have time to get into all of it, but they had demons in water, they had demons in rituals, they had demons in places that you could, in words and things and all kinds of stuff that the New Testament knows nothing about. Every place that evil spirits are mentioned in the New Testament, it's in complete conformity to the Old Testament. So what have you got? With the New Testament text, you've got the Old Testament continued on. In other words, the Word of God continued on with the same author, the Holy Ghost, writing the Scripture. To me, when I read Eder, I believed it, but when I read what Edersheim said, and that's been over 20 years ago, I said to myself, I got to thinking. I thought, yeah, this is not pagan Jews didn't write the New Testament. They wrote about it. And all you got to do is take their Talmud and you'll find out what I'm talking about. Now, who wrote the New Testament then? They were Jews, but they were under the Holy Ghost. The inspiration of the Holy Spirit, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. See the difference? That's a big deal, what I just gave you. That's very important. Because you believe the book, don't you? Where'd the book come from? See? When you have a book in your hand that you know was written contemporary with the pagans and the rest of that garbage, but it's not that kind of book.
Amen.
See? If the New Testament was full of a bunch of superstitious foolishness, I'd have to say to myself, well, good night, man. This is not the Word of God. This is just a bunch of pagan foolishness. But it's not.
Amen.
It's not. It's not. Yes, sir. Yeah. Yeah. Well, yes. Hebrews gets into that. Right. 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 Exactly. All right, now they're blinded. Okay, the Jews are blinded. All right, now, what's blinded them? All right, now let's look at one thing that blinded them. How did Christ die? He died on a what?
Cross.
A cross. He died on a tree. What's the Bible say about that? All right, he died on a cross. He died on a tree. He was cursed. Number two, he died. He died. Now, the Jews have two messiahs, many of them. Mashiach ben Joseph, Mashiach ben David. One of them is the son of Joseph, the other is the son of David. Why do they have two messiahs? Because it's clear in the Old Testament that one of the messiahs is reigning, son of David. But there's one messiah in the Old Testament who suffers. The suffering servant of Isaiah, chapter number 40. The suffering servant of Isaiah. See, you talk to a Jewish rabbi and he'll say, that's Israel. No, it's not. No, I'm sorry. But here's the point. The point is that he is crucified, cursed of God. He died. He couldn't be our Messiah. Our Messiah didn't come to die. He didn't come to set us free. And he is illegitimate, according to them. You remember what they said to him? We be not born of fornication. I know who my daddy is. That's what that meant. That's exactly what it meant. And this is why it went straight into the Talmud. See, I can see it right here in the New Testament. I can see where the Talmud got it. I got it from them. We be not born of fornication. Well, who was his father? Who was the father of the Lord Jesus Christ? Has anybody ever seen him? In other words, he's got a father that nobody's ever seen. I know. But I mean, here you're a Christian. All right, I mean, if you're a born-again, real born-again believer, do you have any problem believing God the Father is the Father of the Lord Jesus? No, you don't have any problem believing that. You have no problem believing that. But you're believing in somebody you've never seen. Nobody's ever seen God. No man's ever seen him. He said, the Lord Jesus said this, no man knows the Father but the Son. No man knows the Son but the Father. And whoever I reveal him to. In other words, I have got to reveal the Father to you. Okay, well, so what's happened here is that with the preponderance of the evidence, it all comes out against Christ, according to the Jew. He didn't qualify. He didn't meet the standard. And so they reject him. Now, but they could have believed on him because the believers in the New Testament were Jews. So what caused them to believe? You remember the question he asked them? He said, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? See? All right. But who spoke up? The fisherman. What did he say? All right. He said, you're the Christ. Okay. Now, that'd been okay. That's fine. That's good. He's the Messiah. That's good. As far as it goes, that's good. But that's not quite far enough. What did he say then? The Son of the living God. He nailed it down then. You can't back off from that one. That's it. The Son of God. He said, Simon Bar-Jonah, flesh and blood hath not revealed that to you, but my Father which is in heaven. All right. Therefore, if you believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, you didn't get it from men. You didn't get it from the earth. You got it from God. You got it from him. That's where it comes from. John 16, when the Spirit of truth has come, he'll guide you into all truth. He'll not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear is speak. He will convince you of sin. Of sin because they believe not on me. The work of the Holy Ghost is to point men and women to the Lord Jesus Christ. But in the New Testament, here they are. They're blinded. Okay? They're blinded. Why are they blinded? What does that mean? What does it mean for the future? What does that mean as it relates to the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven? Well, we're grafted in. They're the natural branch. We're not. You know, all that's in Romans 11. Sure. That's wonderful. But he didn't blind them so he could graft us in. We are grafted in as a consequence of them being blinded. Okay? Now, what does that mean? I'm going to ask you a question. I want you to get ready for this next Sunday. This is Elias, if you will receive him. Because of their unbelief, we are grafted in. Both of these statements are conditional. Aren't they? These are conditional. All right? Yes, sir.
Romans says it's to provoke them to jealousy.
Yes, sir. That's a consequence of it. It provokes them to jealousy. And they wonder why I believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And I believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob as much as any Jew does.
Amen.
I don't believe in Allah. I don't believe in the God of Abraham. I don't believe in the God of Abraham and Isaac. I believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Yes, he is. But remember the two conditional statements.
But they rejected it, so they separated the kingdoms.
Yes, they did. You suppose they caught God off guard when they did that? Poor old Lord, I mean, speaking reverently. He has to figure out what he's going to do now that things didn't work out. Yes, sir. There is national salvation and there is individual salvation. National salvation, though, never has to do with being born again. The new birth is absolutely individual.
Amen.
Right. Right. Okay, we'll pick it up next week, Lord willing. We'll get into the conditional part. All right? The conditional. Because it bears directly on what we're talking about here. All right. Brother Raley, will you dismiss us, please?